Good day, this is Jim Pytel from Columbia Gorge Community College. This is Digital Electronics. This lecture is entitled D Flip-Flops. We are going to take that edge detection device, which we previously discussed, and add it to the front of some previously discussed devices and see how it modifies its behavior. If you remember, the gated SR latch, one of our basic sequential devices, how we created a D latch to that is all we did was took this D input, fed it to S, inverted it, fed it to R, put it in a box, call it a D-latch. Okay? What's the behavior of a D-latch? My description of it is Q follows D when it's enabled. When it's not enabled, Q takes the last value of D. So let's see if we can modify a D-latch with an edge detection device by doing the exact same thing. Taking an edge detection device, in this case it's a positive edge detection device, put it on the front of enable, put it in a box, and call that box a D flip-flop. So now it's kind of the same thing. It follows D when enabled. Well, it's only enabled for a brief moment of time. If you could think about it, it's almost like it's sampling D. Okay, it's taking a quick look at it, and that quick momentary look is instantaneous sampling. And that's the way I like to describe a D flip-flop in contrast to a D latch. Q samples D when it's enabled. It stores that value until it's enabled again. The thing is you have to remember is when is it enabled? In this particular case, it is a positive edge there. What if I had a bubble in front of that? It would be enabled on a negative edge. And this idea of a sample versus follow, a D latch when it's enabled, that enable pulse, say for example, it's active high enable. It's enabled for 50 microseconds. It's taking that D, it's following it, that whole 50 microseconds, as opposed to a positive edge detection device. It samples on that brief moment in time on the positive edge, in this particular case, of a clock signal. Let's go ahead and just try some examples. And again, use this description. You should remember these descriptions. How does an SR latch work? How does a D latch work? How does a D flip-flop work? And just think of the behavior of these things. Okay, here's our first example. We've got a D flip-flop. Is it a positive edge detection or negative edge detection? To me, this looks like it's a positive edge detection device. What is my initial conditions? What I'm saying is Q is initially a zero. How do I do a timing analysis of this? Exact same way I've done the SR latch and the D latch. I figure out when it's enabled. When is this thing enabled? It's enabled on the positive edge. All I do is just find where the positive edges are. Okay, so there's all the positive edges. And what is the behavior of D flip-flop? It samples D when it's enabled. So I just draw lines down. It's sampling it right there, right there, right there. And actually what I should be drawing on that one, what's it sampling? It's sampling a one there. Okay, so just figure out where it's sampling it. You should look like this. Those are all the times that it is sampling that input. And then what does Q do? It's basically assuming those values when it is sampled. So you just go along. It's a zero. It's a zero. It's going to stay a zero until here. It's a one. It's sampling a one. And it's going to stay a one. Even though that D has changed there, it will stay a one until it samples a zero again. You've already figured this out too. Key to some of these analyses is just kind of using a straight edge. You could potentially take a ruler with you to class. You could potentially use a piece of paper as a straight edge. Just kind of figure out when these things are enabled. In this particular example, it was a positive edge detection device. Okay, how would this behave if it was a negative edge detection device, namely Q? How would Q change as a result of that? Here's another follow-up question. How would this change if it was a D latch? Let's say that was active high enabled. How would it change if it was an active low enabled D latch? Okay, so we're using a bunch of terminologies which all sound very similar, but your key to differentiate those things, that Q is going to behave differently for every single one of those descriptions. So let's try another example here. We have a D signal and a clock signal, and we've got Q in this particular example. It's an unknown state. How do we make this thing work? Well, we figure out, okay, when is it enabled? I'm looking at the clock signal. Looks like it's got that description called a positive edge detection device on it. So I figure out when it's enabled. There you go. Those are the only times that's enabled on those positive edges of the clock, not the positive edges of D. That is a number one misconception of people doing these. It's the positive edges on the signal reaching the clock input. Okay, now how does Q respond? I know there's some unknown state. We don't know what's in Q up until it could be a 0, it could be a 1, but kind of at this point we don't care what it was because it's a 1 and it's going to stay a 1 until it's sampled again right there, which is a 0, and it's going to stay a 0 until it's sampled again, which happens to be a 0, and it's going to stay a 0 despite the fact that D is moving now because it's not sampled again right there. And it's going to stay a 1 till it's sampled again, which happens to be a 1. And it's going to stay a 1, despite the fact that D is falling down to a 0. And at that point, it's sampled again. That becomes a 0. Follow-up question. How would this behave if it was a negative edge detection device? And there are some problems in there with a negative edge detection device, which we'll discuss in one of the follow-on lectures regarding flip-flop operating characteristics. But how would this behave if it was a active high D latch, where the clock was being sent to the active high enable? How would it behave if it was an active low D latch? Let's do another example of this. Same type of problem. When is it enabled? It's a negative edge detection device. What is the behavior of a D flip-flop? It samples D when enabled, stores that value. Okay, when is it enabled? It's enabled on negative edges. Okay, there's all the negative edges. It's sampling it here. There, 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 there. What is my initial conditions for Q? I'm saying it was a 1 when we first started. Regardless of what D is, it's going to stay a 1 until it's sampled at that moment, which is a 1, and it's going to stay a 1 despite the fact that D is changing until it's sampled again here, which is a 0, 0, and it's going to stay that way until it's sampled again at a 1 despite the fact that D is changing right there, goes up right there, samples again, it's a 1, and it's going to stay a 1 despite the fact that D is changing right here until it samples D again, which is a 0. Same question. How would this behave if it was an active high D latch? How would it behave if it was an active low D latch? How would it behave if it was a positive edge detection D flip-flop? Okay, so there's a number of different example problems you can get from the same problem. So that should have been a pretty easy understanding of D flip-flops. What I'm going to do is introduce to you now is this concept of asynchronous inputs. Okay, so D, it is a synchronous input. Why is it a synchronous input? Because the only time you ever look at D is with respect to the clock. The clock is synchronizing the activity. There is such a thing called asynchronous inputs. Asynchronous inputs are things that supersede the clock. They can be looked at regardless of wherever the clock is. And what I'm going to do is just give you a basic description of an asynchronous input and just see how you do with it. Don't even worry how these things are hooked up right now. Just think of this. This is a D flip-flop. Pay no attention to the other stuff which I've drawn on it right now. What is it? Well, here is a D input. Here's a positive edge on it, a positive edge detection device. It's a D flip-flop. Here's a Q output. And you also have the not Q output if you want to use it for some reason. Those two things that I've drawn there, those two additional things, are what is known as asynchronous inputs. Meaning, those things can be read without respect to the clock, and they supersede what's ever on the clock. And the two inputs, what I'm calling, is not pre and not clear. Don't call them that. They're called preset and clear. Okay, preset. What that means, what is set? It's a 1. Okay, so if I'm pre-setting something, I'm basically loading everything with a 1. What is a clear? Well, just think about it. It is the empty mind Zen state. There's 0 in there. Clear. I'm clearing the thing out. What is the purpose of these sequential devices? One of the major functions of a sequential device is a memory device. Say, for example, I have a register, which is a storage. Maybe a good idea is prior to using that register, I should clear the whole thing out so there's no garbage in there. Maybe I want to load the whole thing with ones. I'm going to preset it. This bar over it and the bar over it. What that means, well, it's active low. Grab your head, squeeze from both sides because I don't want it to explode. Okay, what does active low mean? It means it's looking for a 0. So if the preset input has a 0 on it, it will load all ones to Q. If clear has a 0 on it, it's going to clear Q. It's going to put 0 on Q. And because they are asynchronous, you don't have to look at the clock. And because they are asynchronous, they supersede inputs based on the clock. That probably hit you like a ton of bricks right there because we haven't really talked about asynchronous. This is the first time I'm introducing it. But let's just try a timing diagram of this. One of the key things to remember about about these timing diagrams, and I still haven't even put D and pre and clear on there, is just think about the behavior. When does the input D, when is the input D being looked at? It's being looked at the positive edge. When is the input pre being looked at? The preset input. When is the clear being looked at? These guys are being looked at all the time. And regardless of what D is doing or the clock is doing, if there's a zero on clear, regardless of what's going on, let's say there's a zero right there for clear. All the rest of the times it's high. What do you think Q is going to be? It's going to be clear. So let's put some inputs on D. Let's put some inputs on preset, and let's put an input on clear. So I've got D incoming data. I've got pre active low preset. I've got clear and active low clear. And remember, preset and clear are asynchronous. You do not have to worry about the clock with those inputs. Right, how do I do a problem with this like this? Well, step one, what type of device is this? Well, it's a D flip-flop with a positive edge detection device. Figure out where the positive edges are. Step two, figure out what the initial conditions for Q are. Well, it's zero. Step three, when does it sample D? Right there, right there, right there, right there, right there, and right there. Step zero. Basically, before all that garbage there, look at this. Pre and clear. They're asynchronous. Don't worry about the clock. Whatever the clock is doing, whatever D is doing, if there is a low on pre, it will preset it. It will put a 1 on Q. If there's a low on clear, it will put a 0 on Q. And it's going to stay that way until the next time the device is enabled. So let's just look at clear. When is it 0? Right there. So basically, it's going to stay a 0 until the next time it's sampled. Right there. So that whole time, Q should be a 0, at which time it's enabled and sampled. Don't worry about that right now, because we're still dealing with the presets and clears. Look at clear again. There's a 0 there. It's active low. It's asynchronous inputs. Regardless of what's going on, from this point forward, Q should be a 0. What happens with preset? It's active low, asynchronous. At this moment right there, regardless of what Q is doing, it's going to put a 1 on Q. And it's going to stay that way until it's sampled again. So what I'm doing is forget all the clocks, forget all the Ds. Before you do anything, look at the presets and the clears. They're active low asynchronous inputs. Now, go ahead and do step 1 through 3. Okay, where are my positive edges? There they are. They've sampled it. At that particular time, it's being sampled right here again. It is a 0, and it will stay a 0 until it's sampled again. So it's going to go along right about here, changes up to a 1, goes along until it's sampled again, right about there, and it's going to stay a 1, and it just so happens to be a 1 when it's preset, at which point it's sampled again, which is a 0 right there, and it's going to stay a 0 until it is sampled again at a 0, and it just so happens to have that clear at that time. Getting those presets and clears before you've been doing the timing analysis is absolutely important to this. And again, this is an added functionality to this device here. Let's say, for example, I've got this in a register application or a counter that I want to reset to state 0. All I do is just give every single device hooked up in that thing an active low clear, clears the whole thing out, and I can use it again. Okay, let's go on to discuss the next sequential logic device with an edge detection device, the JK flip-flop.